So we are marking that 15th anniversary of those terrorist attacks on September 11th, 2001. And I'll repeat that question Pastor Bruce asked you. Do you remember where you were when you first heard that news of the planes crashing into the Twin Towers, the New York's World Trade Center? I'll let you take a moment to think, to remember as that time unfolded. There are those of you here who lost people that day, people you know. I was sitting in a conference on the East Coast and watching it unfold in real time on television, sitting there with a man who was watching it and wondering if his colleagues were going to make it out of the office in time. As the day wore on, and that plane went crashing into the Pentagon, I remember the irony of a restaurant that was there in the center of the Pentagon. The name of the restaurant was Ground Zero. I'm Pastor Wayne. I'll do this morning's first sermon segment. My brother pastors Mark and Bruce will do additional segments, so I'll invite you now to pray with me. Almighty God, you have said, be still and know. Oh Lord, that we might know that you are God, that we might put our trust in you and place our hope in you, seeking your grace, seeking your comfort, seeking your peace. So Lord, today as we look into your word, as we consider those events, oh Lord, still our hearts that we may indeed know that you and you alone are God. Amen. God was not shocked on 9/11. Oh yes, we were shocked. Do you remember your shock as the events unfolded that day? The World Trade Center, the Pentagon, a meadow in Pennsylvania. But God, I repeat, was not shocked. God is all-knowing. Scripture says the eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. Psalm 139 says, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? We are clearly in God's sight. And we always have been. Psalm 139 continues, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there were none. Not one of the 3,000 victims, the 3,000 deaths on 9/11, came as a surprise to our Lord. He knew all of their days, for each one of them, from before they were born. So since God knew all of these things, I ask you, was he helpless to stop 9/11? I'm confident of this. God was not helpless. I've trusted in that for years. In my previous career, I was a special agent for an agency that today is called Homeland Security. During the Cold War, it was my job to keep weapons of mass destruction, our strategic weapons, missiles and such, out of the hands of the Russians and other of my country's enemies. Some people, though, would ask me, given the worldwide weapons proliferation, don't you sometimes just feel like giving up? But my answer was always in the confidence, in the power of the living God. Psalm 46 says, God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the sea, nations rage, kingdoms totter, the Lord utters his voice, the earth melts. You see, we humans may believe that we have terrifying weapons, but the psalmist reminds us he utters his voice and the earth melts. That's real power. That's the power of the same one who created the universe. The psalmist continues. He says, the Lord of hosts is with us. He is our fortress. The Lord says, be still and know that I am God. He is the one in whom we can take sanctuary and peace. The one who says, be still and know that I am God. So where was God on 9/11? He was active throughout, in every moment, in every corner of every place, providing strength, providing comfort. Our Lord says, as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. Psalm 23, we know those familiar words, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. As we consider how God might view 9/11, allow me to share some words from an unknown poet called Meet Me in the Stairwell. They imagine how God might speak to you in a letter. You say you will never forget where you were when you heard the news on 9/11. Neither will I. I was on the 110th floor in a smoke-filled room with a man who called his wife to say goodbye. I held his fingers steady as he dialed. I gave him the peace to say, honey, I am not going to make it, but it's okay. I'm ready to go. I was with his wife when he called. I held her up as she tried to understand his words and as she realized he wasn't coming home that night. I was on the stairwell of the 23rd floor when a woman cried out to me for help. I've been knocking on the door of your heart for 50 years, I said. Of course, I'll show you the way home. Only believe in me now. I want you to know that I saw every face. I knew every name, though not all knew me. Some met me for the first time on the 86th floor. Some sought me with their last breath. Some chose, for the final time, to ignore me. But I was there. The letter closes, love God. It was terrifying. But God was there. And trusting in him, we can know peace. When our Lord says, be still and know that I am God. Amen.
Will you join me in prayer? Lord, thank you as we move through this service. Thank you for your continued presence. that you speak and lead and guide us. So continue to do this, Lord, as we open the scriptures another time. Speak to us, Lord, and guide us. Guide us, your people, and how you would want us to live and what you would call us to be in this broken and hurting world. Lord, speak. We're listening. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, there's nothing wrong, of course, it's human, to be afraid at times. There are times it'd be silly not to be afraid. We've all felt it. It might have been at a time when you're facing a car accident or something coming at you, a car on the highway, and it terrifies you, justly, rightly. And there's a sense of gratitude and peace that you pass the danger successfully and safely. It could be other things. I can remember when we lived in London, to get to our flat was a walkway along a soccer pitch. It was overgrown with trees, and it was usually fairly dark, and there'd been a lot of incidents along that path. And I can remember on more than one occasion having to walk that path in the dark and hearing footsteps behind me. It was a fairly heavily traveled path. But still, walking along a dark path where there's trouble and hearing people, someone walking behind you, there's a fear inside. For me, I don't go near the ocean because there's big things that eat you in it. I'm afraid of it. I admit that. And it's sensible. It's rational. It's reasonable. There's nothing wrong with being afraid. But there is something wrong for Christians, maybe all of us, to be governed by fear. It is not what God intends. There are times, for whatever reason, we actually have fear become the controlling emotion in our lives. We're terrified of all kinds of different things, great and small, and we're certain that it's going to be the worst and the darkest that will prevail. And this is not true. It's not true for the world. It's not true for Christians. And God calls us to be something different. To see this, the best way perhaps is just to turn right to Jesus and to see him, see how he dealt with his disciples and to learn from that how he wants to deal with us, how he's dealing with us right now, this morning, what he's calling us to do and to be. And so I want to give you this morning from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, beginning at verse 35, Jesus calming the storm. It's a great passage. In the history of the church, whenever the Gospels are read to show honor to the Lord Jesus, the church would stand, and so I invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel. And listen to these words. It's after Jesus had spent a long day teaching parables and sitting in a boat. And it says these words. Now, at the end of the day, Jesus said to his disciples, "Come, let's sail across the lake and go to the other side." So they took him there in the boat in which he'd already been sitting, and set sail. And they left the crowd behind, though a number of boats sailed along with him. Now it happened that a huge squall fell upon them, and the wind howled and the waves beat so fiercely upon the side of the boat that it was already being swamped. But Jesus was in the back of the boat, stretched out on a cushion and sound asleep. The disciples came to him. They shook him awake and they said, "Teacher, is it of no concern to you that we are about to go under?" Jesus shook himself awake and spoke to the wind and said, "Be still." And then turning to the waves, he said, "Be calm." And in an instant, the wind stopped, and the sea was as smooth as glass. And then he turned to his disciples, and he said, "Why do you live as such cowards? Do you not yet have faith?" But they were overwhelmed with a different kind of fear. And they began to say to one another, "Who is this man that can speak a word and wind and waves obey?" The word of the Lord. Please be seated. You see Jesus on the boat, sound asleep. He's untroubled, and it's a great image for us. He's untroubled by whatever the disasters, the noise, the dangers of the world. He's untroubled. He had absolute, total peace that God was in control, that he would not be a victim of fate. He would not be a victim of bad events or bad people. He was under God's control. And as Wayne said a moment ago, God is in absolute, utter control. So Jesus is stretched out on the back on a cushion. You got to like that. Everybody likes a cushion, even the Lord. He's stretched out, sound asleep, and the wind hits, and the waves are beating, and the boat's about to go down. And it's fishermen who come to him, fishermen who are well aware of the danger that they're in, and saying, we're about to perish. Notice they don't call him Lord. They call him teacher. And they don't ask anything. They rebuke him. They criticize him. They say, are you even aware of what's going on? Is it of no concern to you? Do you not even care about us? We're about to perish. We're about to go under. It's a blunt criticism. There's not a word of kindness, not a word of faith, not a word of request in this. It's pure criticism and pure terror. They're afraid. I love how it says Jesus shakes himself awake. And he rebuked the wind. It's a strong word. He rebuked it. It's a word that's commonly used in all the Gospels for how he addresses the demonic. Knock it off. He rebuked them. Knock it off. And the words are strong. The best way to see it is something like, shut up. That's literally what it is in the Greek. Shut up. And then the next word, put a muzzle on it. Literally what it is. Put a muzzle on it. And the wind and the waves do it. Can you imagine if you were camping or going on a hike with your kids? I think of that time living in London or on that narrow, dark alley and sometimes walking with my little girls and holding them and being nervous. Can you imagine in a different setting, you take my little girls and we're out in the woods and a massive grizzly bear stands right around the corner with its cubs all around it, and we've walked right in it. And it roars with ferocity. And the girls scream with terror. And we are in a dangerous situation. Can you imagine what it'd be like if you or a ranger steps forward and faces the bear and says, shh, sit. And he does. That would change your view of a ranger. Imagine that. And Jesus did something great. He basically said to the wind and the wave, shh, sit. And they did. And then he turned to the disciples and he said, why were you so afraid? And it's a different word for fear. It's not the most common word in the New Testament, in the Greek, for fear. It's, that would be phobos, where we get phobia. It's delos. Why are you so delos? Why are you this fearful people? It can mean fear. Why were you afraid? But it means more than that. It takes it to a different level. It's not just describing a feeling that they had, but a characteristic that they were displaying. Why are you cowardly? Why is your nature cowardly? It's a strong word, and it occurs in a lot of different places in the Bible, the same word. You remember in 2 Timothy, Paul writes to his young protege, and Paul's on the edge of getting killed for his faith. Timothy's facing hard things, and he says, don't be afraid, Timothy, for God did not give us a spirit of fear, delos. He did not give us a cowardly spirit, but something very different, a spirit of power, a spirit of love, a spirit of self-control. And in the Gospel of John, Jesus says these great words. He says, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. I don't give it to you as the world gives it. Do not let your hearts be distressed or lacking in courage. Do not let your hearts be distressed or deloi, fearful, cowardly. The reason we can trust in this world that we're safe ultimately is because Jesus is Lord. There is no power that can stop him. There is no force that can turn his will, and he will prevail. He is going to work this world out in a good and faithful way, even though there are troubles and hardships. It's our job to remain faithful, to trust him, and to be his people in this troubled and anxious world, to not be a people who are controlled by fear, but a people who are courageous and bold. This is a different world. It's a broken and hurting world, and it needs people who are confident that Jesus has not left it or abandoned us, but is on the throne and can be trusted for good. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your grace and your kindness, for your mercy. And we pray you would help us be courageous in this troubled world when there is so much violence. Give us courage, Lord, in your precious name. Amen.
Well, it is entirely appropriate on a morning like this morning, a morning where we want to take the opportunity to remember, to remember a distinct national tragedy. There's that sense that we would hope we would never forget. The thousands of lives lost, the attack on this country, the resolve that we would continue to live as a nation committed to particular freedoms and particular expressions and particular politics. But that word remember for the church never simply means to recollect, to think about, maybe with fondness or heaviness. To remember biblically, to remember for the church, always means to act in a particular manner. So we have to ask at some point on a morning like this morning, what is the church and its people, believers, to do in these times, especially as citizens of this nation? We who swear allegiance to no other king as Lord and Savior, we who serve no greater kingdom than that of our King, Jesus Christ, we who live under no flag raised higher than that of the cross of Jesus Christ. What are we, the church, to do? Citizens first and foremost of the kingdom of God, but also citizens of a nation with a constitution and a bill of rights that are unparalleled in giving its people freedom of expression, choice of belief, allowing different standards of morality and character, even those having nothing to do with biblical character or godly will. What are we to do? Well, we must, of course, live in such a manner that is nothing short of biblical. It is one of the great challenges that we face in a nation that affords us so much freedom, that we might take that for granted. It is a church and church people who are called by God and His Word to act justly, to love with steadfast loving kindness, to walk humbly with our God. In other words, to go where God leads, love what God loves, act in the manner that God acts, especially in the ways of justice, mercy, compassion to the oppressed, the poor, and even the alien. It is in Christ alone we are set free. And it is walking in the same manner in which Christ walked that we live freely into His freedom. And it is to that end we are exhorted to pray. To the end that we pray even for our country and its leaders. There is one passage in Scripture that exhorts believers to pray for those in positions of leadership. Paul, writing to the young pastor Timothy, urged him in leading the church in Ephesus with these words from the first letter of Timothy, chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. First of all, then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful life. Quiet life, godly, dignified in every way. This is good, and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. These are the words of the Lord. I believe it is fair and good to understand these words for our time, our place in this world as well. We are to pray for the leadership of this country that we live in. We must. We are urged to. And pray for all of its leadership, even those that we would disagree with politically, morally even. Even those for whom we feel a strong dislike. We pray for their salvation. We pray for their governing with justice and compassion, strength of character, and uprightness in lawmaking. We are urged to find reasons to be thankful for them. We are urged to intercede, to pray in their stead for God to guide, that they would have the Spirit to give them wisdom and counsel. But note this, the context of Paul's urging, his exhortation to pray for our leaders. We pray for them in order that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. We cannot pray for America and its leadership and then sit back and expect this nation or any other nation to be and to do that for which God has given his own life and death in Jesus. It is the church and church people, those who would profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, who are called to be the kingdom of God happening here on earth just as it is in heaven. We cannot pray for our nation and its leaders and then expect them to be or do what we are called to be and who we are called to be. We cannot abdicate our moral responsibility to act justly, to love mercy, to walk humbly with God, expecting any other nation to pick up the call for which God has only given to the church. So pray indeed. Pray for freedom. Pray for laws within our nation. Pray for our leaders to exhibit righteous behavior and decision-making. Pray for their salvation. But recognize that such prayers are lifted up ultimately that there would be freedom and ability for God's people, for the church, for us to live in such a manner as to be the shalom of God, the heart, the character, the will of God in this nation, in this world, to this world, for the glory of God. So let's pray. And as I pray, I encourage you to lift up the names of our leaders in your own hearts. Again, even those you may disagree with, those you may dislike, let us pray. Father, we thank you for this word, this challenge, this exhortation, urging to pray for our leaders. We recognize that it is often difficult. We confess we often simply don't. Following the teaching of your word, we would lift up the leaders of this nation in which we live, under whose laws we live and have such tremendous freedom. We lift up our president, our vice president, our nation's senators and representatives, our state's governors, lieutenant governors, representatives and senators, our county, city, community leaders, mayors and councils. We do ask that you would give them wisdom. Help them to see and to hear your laws, your character. Understand and live within your moral code. Have a willingness to hear your word. That those who don't know you would come to faith in you, proclaiming Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. For those who do profess you, that they would live faithfully, govern faithfully. Father, we pray in this nation that affords us so much freedom, that we, your people, would not take the freedom for granted, not abdicate our responsibility, that we would indeed live into the prayer that your own Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.